We are here because of Bruce LeVell and because of the fact Donald Trump needs somebody in Congress that is willing to fight for his agenda. His agenda is what the people were drawn to. Voters in 2016 sent a very, very loud message to our nation. They sent a loud message to Congress. Sometimes, from what I've seen over the past few weeks, I think there are a few that are tone deaf to the message that was sent. Bruce will advance President Trump's agenda. He will be a hard worker for the people of the 6th District. He will work just as hard and be just as loyal to voters of the 6th District as he was to our President of the United States. Bruce will give you a little bit of background. He's the managing partner of Dunwoody Diamonds USA and LeVell Properties LLC. He was the former chairman of the Gwinnett Republican Party, which he did a phenomenal job, by the way, because I live in Gwinnett, and he raised a ton of money. He was tapped to be the executive director of President Donald Trump's National Diversity Coalition during the 2016 campaign. He was honored to be a Trump campaign top media surrogate for national news and a national delegate for Trump at the 2016 National Convention. Let's give a big round of applause to the man of the hour, Bruce LeVell.
Corey was that motivator, that and doing rallies and running back and forth and running and back and back. If it wasn't for Corey back there pushing him, he would not be in the Oval Office. And it was so funny, like in the beginning, you know, we flew down, and our member was him, Hope Hicks, and Michael Glassner, Scavino, the pilot, John, and a couple other folks. Couldn't find anybody else, you know. And then when I came back and flew, when he became the nominee, I couldn't find a seat on the plane. We're best friends. We're meet Bruce. No, you know. So I know what you mean, but, you know, the tag-alongs, the clean-alongs, but that's okay. As long as they vote and they come together. You know, it has been a journey. And I'll get to the reason why I'm running in this race. First off, shout out to the owner of the facility, Mr. Simpson. Where are you at? You here? Okay. So anyway, it's great. So this is a private owned business. When I wanted this facility, I said, let's get someone that owns a business. Let's not get a big corporate, let's get someone small business and let's bless them. So that's why we're here tonight. So just want to let them know why we're here. That's some of the things I think about constantly. I'm always thinking about others, thinking about how we can improve, how we can help someone. That's my spirit, and that's just who I am. But let me give you a little background about where I come from, or where I came from. I was born in right outside of a military base in Fort Lewis, and my mother, my dad was in the service. He's a retired sergeant major. He did two tours of Vietnam. And some of us remember how that was as a child. Some of us remember what it was like in that era. But my background is, my mother had my sister who's 4 years older than me, and she had some extreme complications. She almost died having her. And, you know, it was a rough time back then, 1961 at the time. But when she was going to the doctor, she would pass by this facility. And this facility is a place where they kept children. Back then they called them orphanages. Now they call them group homes and all types of little fancy names, but essentially back then it was called an orphanage. And so she was driving by this facility, and she said one day the Lord told her to just pull in there. And she pulled in there, and she walked in, and she walked through this little room, and there was a big glass door, and it had little lines and stuff. And she looked down there, and she said, who's that little guy over there? So the nurses, the people that worked at the facility went and picked up the little boy, brought him up front, and came up to the front, and she picked him up and said, well, how do I take this little boy home? And so I was adopted. My mother picked me up out of that orphanage. And back then, you know, my biological mom was German, and my dad was African American. And y'all know back in those days, you know, it was really rough on mulatto kids. You know, we usually got put up for homes, but I will tell you, this is very interesting, and you'll know where I stand on this part, is that we were the most highly aborted children. Because we weren't mixed, we weren't white enough, we weren't black enough, but we were aborted fastest. And my mother always told me that I was a chosen child. I never figured out what she meant, chosen. Wow, that sounds like some Obi-Wan Kenobi stuff. You know? And I often remember it if she would have not stopped in where I would be today. I don't think I would have ever met the beautiful people in this room. But what it taught me, it gave me a heart for people, and it gave me a heart for reconciliation, multicultural. And then here I am running the largest diversity coalition in the history of the United States for a 70-year-old white guy from New York. Really cool? No, that's really. National Diversity Coalition for Trump, we're over a million plus. Manchin's here. Haitian Americans for Trump. Vivian Childs back there. Beautiful Sisters for Trump. Where's Carlos? Carlos Lamon. He left early. Mexican Americans for Trump. Kevin Doe, Vietnamese Americans for Trump. There he is right there, guys. Yeah. Michael Abramson, Jewish Americans for Trump, right here. Am I missing some more coalition members in here? I know, we got somebody from the map. That's right. But you know, that right there tells you the heart and the passion I have for people. And I love people, I love their hearts, all different shades and sizes, beautiful people. And that's my gift. I'm a very good negotiator. The reason why I'm a negotiator, and I always said the key to being success and being a negotiator is loving people. Think about it. No matter what religion you are, Jew, Christian, Muslim, it don't matter. The heart. And that's a very powerful tool that my mom taught me and that God blessed me with. And that's a really, it just boils inside of me. And I think, when I think back during the campaign, when, you know, I've done every media hit from, you can imagine, CNN, Fox, Al Jazeera, Turkish News, BBC, NBC, ABC. You know, every question that I was asked was like, you know, President Trump is a racist, President is a racist. That hurts. Because, you know, especially, because I know what racism is, trust me. Believe me, I do. And Donald Trump is not like that, is he, Corey? No way. No way. So that journey taught me a lot. And let me tell you, when, you know, for a guy like me to serve as your congressman, if I'm not battle-tested, I don't know what is. I mean, you think about it. You think about the journey. You think about all the media. I literally put my whole entire life, my whole person on national TV. I mean, everyone knows everything about me. Just Google me. There's no secrets. Lord knows I've been vetted, because you don't get on that plane with Secret Service with some drama. I'll tell you that right now. Excuse me, we need to have a conversation. So, I know I'm qualified, ladies and gentlemen. You know, I didn't really plan to run for Congress, and I'm going to tell you why I am running. There's many reasons. One of the biggest reasons was when I saw the candidates lining up, I know who never Trump was, and I know who was against the president. I knew who was, who wasn't. And the candidates in this field, except for one, Amy Kramer, none of them would support the president. I begged and pleaded. Corey and I talked about this in the car on the way over. Even when he became the nominee and I was a national delegate, I pleaded with all the Republicans, please, please, come on, come on. They sat on their hands, didn't they, Corey? They sat on their hands. And they're still sitting on it. They're pretending. So I said, you know what? With all these great initiatives, the president wants to implement a $1 trillion infrastructure program. Atlanta has the worst traffic in the nation. I'm the only candidate talking about transportation. Isn't that right, Mayor Mike Davis?
That's right.
I'm the only one. Everyone's talking about, I want less government overreach. Oh, the same old, same old. You know, Avita King. Hello, Avita King. Just walking in. There she is. Martin Luther King's niece right here. Say hello. I love when she calls me randomly and like, come on, brother, let's pray. I feel like 1, 12, 11 at night. Okay, let's do it. No, that's serious. I really mean that. Those prayers really help. It keeps me fueled. It keeps me motivated. Thank you, Ms. King, for those prayers. I really appreciate it. She does a lot. She's like, she got the Fox contract, you know. But, you know, we have sued it. But, you know, it's I looked around the other candidates and I said, you know, they don't have a best interest to help. And, you know, one thing of value that I do bring is the fact, like Corey says, I do know the president well. I'll just see him next week. I'm going to go see him. My daughter works in the West Wing with Spicer, Leah LeVell. She started with the coalition also for college Republican, young Republicans for Trump. She started there and then went to the RNC and then went to work in the West Wing. What a blessing for the head. Amen. Thank you. Amen. But, you know, one thing about being on that trail, I got to meet some incredible people, you know, like Corey and Nick Scavino, Michael Glassman, Kellyanne Conway, Sarah Huckabee, you know, Secretary Kale, she's over at the transportation, Steve Bannon, Jared Kushner, Eric Trump, Ivanka Trump, Ivanka was with my wife, you know, the whole family. They treated me like a family member. I really got to have some great relationships during the campaign. You really find out who your real friends are when things are really tough. Think about it, guys. It was really tough during the campaign. And, you know, I said, you know, I could literally take this relationship as a United States congressman, not just a Georgia 6th congressman, but a United States congressman. That's what it says, U.S. congressman. That's a heavy lift. It's also a heavy lift to say, whatever that we need that we could bring back to Georgia, I guarantee you there's no better negotiator than me in that ballot that people are running for. I guarantee you that. There's no one. Nobody. Because the president, he all knows who we're all talking mess and hating and all. They know. Can't hide. So why not leverage that? Why not leverage that relationship? Think about it, guys. Leverage that relationship. You know, we were blessed in Atlanta. We have such a great growth. We have the largest airport in the world. As of February 25th, we have the worst traffic corridor in the nation. Y'all know that? 400-285. Number one, the worst. Whether you like light rail, heavy rail, extend MARTA, we don't want to extend MARTA, whatever. But at the end of the day, who will have a better play to try to fight to bring your tax dollars back to this district than me?
Nobody.
It's common sense. And here's the best part about this. One thing that really attracted me about supporting President Trump was this right here. Corey, you remember this. Not beholding to special interests. Okay? Not getting involved in PACs. And you saw him tweet about that one PAC that went and boogered up Dr. Price's deal in the House. We'll get to that in a second. And I was like, oh my God, that's so refreshing. A candidate that will not get in bed with special interest groups. That means he has no favors. Ladies and gentlemen, wait till we finish our appointments for ambassadors. Right, Corey? No, the president doesn't owe anybody anything. They don't owe him. He's free to choose the best qualified. All the cabinet members, and all that, there was no pay to play. You know how refreshing that is for our democracy, for our republic? Think about it. Historically, Democrats and Republicans have always, it's always who raised the most money, and who had the kickback, what lobbyists made the deal in order to get those appointments. Think about it. Think about how refreshing that is. Imagine a United States congressman, right here, that had disemboweled in writing, I will not accept any PAC money or any PAC support, no lobby money, no nothing. Right, Mayor Mike?
Right.
Yeah? Yeah. That's why it's hard. That's why it's hard, guys. I remember a PAC called me right after the race. I shared with Mayor Davis. And, you know, I said, listen, I don't want to be involved, man. Just leave me out. Well, they will run against you. See what I mean? And they're getting involved in the race right now. John Mosso, that's a PAC. Club Grove, what do you say, Dan? What do you call it again? What's that pack up there?
Club for Grove.
Club for Grove, the one the president hates, is already jumped in the race, going against another Republican, getting in bed with another Republican. All you gotta do is disavow it, right?
Right.
All you gotta do is send out a press statement to the press. I disavow this. That's all you have to say. They won't do it, you know why? They want the money, Alice. That's right. It's hard, but let me tell you something. Nobody owns Bruce LeVell except Jesus. And it is hard because, you know, they just had a poll and they polled in East Cobb 420 votes and they're trying to push back the Trump guy. Like, we don't want Bruce in here. I mean, seriously, think about it. They don't want him. Really. But they don't want someone that can go up there where they can't have a connection to in terms of access. Access meaning pay to play. There's a candidate right now taking lobby fundraisers right now as we speak. Right now as we speak, taking lobby money. Because that all of a sudden the lobbyist thinks they're their friends and now they want to, hey, you're my best friend now. Only because they need access. Ladies and gentlemen, listen carefully on this. This applies to all races. City Council, State House Rep, State Senate, when you look at the ballot, make sure that the candidate, he or she, what I just said, is not linked to any special money or PAC. Trust me on this. Trust me. Because you have a president of the United States right now that proved it can be done. Think about it. $46 million, right, Corey, from the time of June 2015, to the primary, $46 million, right? $46 million, what they said, is that lean? We're running a lean campaign. We're cash flowing, our bills are paid. I don't owe anyone, all my vendors are paid. We run a tight ship, that is true, Corey. That's the same way I run my business, because I got my wife. That's when I'm in trouble. No, Sharon is the backbone of everything I've ever done. And I appreciate it, honey. I love you. Yeah. get special interest out of the voting election. We got to get rid of it. We got to hold that accountable. And I don't know where God's taking me in this journey. We'll see. I feel in my heart I can do this. I know I can do it. I'm battle tested. Lord knows we're battle tested, aren't we, Mark? You know, just get on national TV and then write. It's so funny when I just come off like CNN or MSNBC. I would literally time and take steps from the time my Twitter would blow up being called names. And I got to like 10, 14 seconds one time. And it's just boom, 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 boom. I don't want to tell you the names, but it humbled me, but it also, it tested me. If you can handle this, like God says, you know, the secret of success is like, if I can trust you with this over here, then I know I can trust you with this over here. You know, Corey, God's like, I'm going to trust you to get President Trump to the primary. And then he's got something else for Corey. Think about it. You ran the baton, he handed it off. All right, y'all got this? I didn't want him to go, don't go, Corey. But that's how it is, though. That's how it is for me, in my spirit, in my heart. And, you know, the other part of this is why I'm running, and I promise I won't be long-winded because I know y'all got to go tuck your kids in bed and tuck mom in bed, like Bubba. We'll tuck Lauren in, right? Is that my wife and I were victims of government overreach. And what Corey said about government overreach, this happened, some of us remember back in 08 and 09 when the TARP, y'all remember the TARP money? The taxpayers' money that were given to banks, and then the FDIC took it and gave it to another bank. Well, we invested in life savings in one of our buildings, and we were in great standings, did what we were supposed to do, got the appraisal, did the down payment, did the financials, you know, blah, 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 blah. And then another bank acquired it, and then this bank acquired it, it failed. So when this bank failed, I got a call, I'll never forget that banker, said, Mr. LeVell, it's so nice knowing you, but we're being escorted out by the FDIC. They seized us. I'm like, whoa, okay, well, I'm paying you on time. So they took the asset, the FDIC, and I won't say the name, honey. She said, don't mention the bank's name. And handed it to this big, big bank, the bank that they said is too big to fall. Yeah, right. Okay. And then we get a call, from this banker I never knew. And says, Mr. Lavelle, I'm your new banker, and I just want to let you know that we're going to call your loan. What? $3 million? What are you going to call the loan for? Well, we don't want it on our books anymore. What do you mean you don't want it on our books anymore? You got $400,000 down payment. You got money. You got our hard-earned money in that. Well, things are different right now, and I'm sorry, we just can't. We just don't want it anymore. Now, you think about that, guys. Think about that. Some of us have similar stories in our own homes that are underwater. Some of us have friends and family or business owners that went through that. But then one of my good friends said, hey, Bruce, why don't you call your elected officials and tell them about this horrible thing you're doing? So I called a few U.S. congressmen, called senators, state house reps, state senators, banking committee chair people. Let me tell you what they said. Oh, Mr. and Mrs. LeVell, I'm sorry. There's nothing we can do as the economy. I'm sorry. If I heard that word, every time I heard sorry, I'd be a millionaire. I'm sorry. So then one of my good friends, he says, why don't you go look at their campaign coffers? Huh? Yeah, go see who's been giving them money while they're elected officials. See who's been supporting them. So I started going through their campaign. By the way, the campaign coffers are open to the public, ladies and gentlemen. Ain't that right, Dave? They're open to the public. Now, here's another thing. I would challenge all my candidates, right, of people in the race. I would disclose all mine right now. I bet you they won't. I know why they won't. When I went and looked at some of these, most, they were tied to special interest. So they were beholden to the special interest. They weren't beholden to Bruce and Sharon LeVell. Now, I'm one of the bold people that's willing to put all my laundry, everything out to the public and tell you everything about me, what I went through. Now, you imagine that. You come to this town with $35 and you save up with your wife. You pawn your car. You hop your title to your car. You you hock your credit cards, you sell your wedding silver. Remember that? You sell your wedding silver. No, I'm serious. How we start our business. And you look at her and said, you realize, honey, we are 30 days of being homeless if this doesn't work. Do you have faith in this? Of course we did. My mother taught me how to tithe and pray. So with that being said, I said to her, fast forwarding the story, if I'm ever granted by God to serve the people, I would stand in front of a Mack truck and never let that happen to you. And you. And you. I would never let that happen to you. And the only way I can do that is I can't get on the tank. And it's hard, guys. It really is. Running campaigns is hard, right, Corey? It's very hard. But at the end of the day, nobody owns me. See? There's no back door. Bruce, you get in. We need this. And we'll try to pass a bill to get this and this kickback or this junket. And these hidden LLCs overseas and the Cayman Islands that some of these guys have. Oh, no, I know. Oh, yeah. Because I'm angry. It just didn't happen to me, and sure, it happened to millions of America. That's what put Donald Trump in office. Think about it, guys. And my challenge to everyone in here, yeah, I want to win. But I also want you to challenge some of your neighbors and your friends to run on those standards where nobody owns you, where you don't have to worry about owing somebody because they took their money. That's power. It's also power to the conscience to look your wife in the eyes, your children, your friends, and know that you didn't sell out. That's peace for me. I don't know about you guys. And it's carried us all through the storms in our family, in our business, our marriage, 25 years, February 14th, Valentine's Day. I want to be like my best friend, J.C. White, here in GB right here, and Mr. Clark. His beautiful, significant half right there. Isn't she lovely? That's the value that I can bring. And I got many more stories because my communications guy is doing these signals telling me to shut up. Right? Just all this kind of stuff. But my heart is very pure about this, guys. And I want to do this. And, you know, I look at the president as a friend, Corey as a friend. You know, it's a journey, it's a battle, it's a war. It's a flat-out war. And I want a lot of Bruce LeVells, more across the country, to step up, serve these seats. And don't get on the tank. Just do what's right. Do what's right. This is what's bleeding. It's not a Democrat situation. It's a Democrat and Republican situation. That's what the president's going through right now, guys. That health care bill, 124-page doc. I read it twice. You believe that? I read it. I did. Dr. Price wrote that. He went with other doctors, and they got together with health care workers. They put this together. Was it the greatest? Probably not. But it was a start. But guess what happened? PACs got involved, and special interest caucuses got involved, and it died. We cut our nose off and spied our face. That's what we did. And the reason why we couldn't get it done, because the folks who are elected in the offices are still beholden. So what do you got to do? That's what the swamp means, guys. That's where the drain of the swamp comes from. Think about it. Can I get amen?
Amen.
But anyway, I just want to close on this. I want to thank the campaign team, Joe and Dan Weissman. Thank Channel 46, Mike, for coming out. Hey, Mike. I love your red tie. A special thanks to Corey. You know, it means a lot when someone comes down here and puts their name on you. It means a lot. I really choked up over there when he was talking. I'm still very choked up because, you know, when you put your name on someone, it's what's the word when we're telling the pastors at that meeting of Trump Towers, we said, look, once we get on that elevator, there's no turning back. You remember that, Pastor? Woo! Oh, Jesus. How do you remember that? But that means a lot to me. And I'm going to tell you something. And everybody knows Bruce LeVell by about me, my character, that a lot of y'all know about me. Who's that supposed to thank? None of your point, Pastor Burns. And I've just been looking at him, talking to him. I talk to him every day. I feel like, Pastor Burns, I appreciate you coming out all the way from South Carolina. Mayor Mike Davis, right here. Trevor Williams. Uncle Joe, moving kind of slow over there. Sharon Christian, who's a beautiful bride right here. Telfar County, all the way from Telfar County. Sharon. Sharon. Nice to meet you all. Woo. Commissioner McDonald's beautiful bride. You're awesome. Lisa Colley and her friends here. She's a, oh my God. And JC, I know you might be calling you out, but JC is a very dear friend of mine. You know, I can call JC and pretty much talk to him about anything. And when I say this respectfully. You gotta have younger friends and you have to have elder friends. And JC is one of my elder friends. GB is one of my younger friends. No, seriously, JC is a very wise man, very wise. He emails me a lot of great, he thinks I don't see it because you don't have ADHD, but I actually read it, believe it or not. You know, and I'm truly thankful for you, JC. And Mr. Clark, you've just been there. You're like a rock, man. I get speechless about the things you supported me with, and I really appreciate you very much. And Vivian, you're the rock. You call and we pray. Vivian Childs back there. And Rodney, the photographer right there. Rodney, say hello. Jane Calloway, right here. Jane, say hello, Jane. Who keeps us safe? Keeps us security. The security detail, Warville in the house, where you at? Jonathan over here, Jonathan Hulston, he's a great guy right here. Aspiring attorney right here. Where's Ellen Deal right here? Where's Ellen? Ellen Deal right here, the rock. Keeps everybody organized. Now, where's Whitney? Whitney Houston, where are you at? Whitney, no, I'm just kidding. Whitney, hi Whitney. Thanks, Whitney. Whitney. Marcy, she's awesome right here. She's beautiful too. Harlan, the DJ, we go back, of course. Debbie, woof, you're awesome. It's like a battle. It's like a jungle. Sometimes I wonder how I keep from going under.
But we fought many battles.
That's right.
We did. Won.
Many more. Yeah. And did I forget anyone else? Mr. Yarrington, right here. Awesome. Did I forget anyone? I'm just thanking everybody. I'm just going through the list. I really appreciate it. So anyway, like Corey says, if you have friends, tell them about us. Yes, we'll take your money, of course. You know, and I'm thankful for everyone giving to, by the way. I'm truly blessed. And it's LeVellForCongress.com.